Okay, so the talk is on ensemble Kanban filters. I start working on this subject when I came back from Australia in 2016. And I was surprised there were some theoretical work, but not so much. So it was the opportunity for me to learn and understand this subject. So since, let's say, 5 years, we have been working on this subject. So the talk of today is a mixture of plenty of works we did with Julian, Aline Kurzmann, Hugo, Adrian Bishop, and so on. So I put all the links. So if you just click on one of them, you will have the article will open. Maybe I will recommend you to see the review article written by Adrian, who is, let's say, a review article on what is inside all of these articles. But the talk of today is more or less a synthesis of these works. So let's start the talk. First, I will remind you what is the Kalman filter. So I've been working in continuous time because the formulas are easier to handle. So I'm working nowadays more on discrete time, trying to understand the discrete time model, but it's a little more difficult to handle. So let's go to continuous time. So you have the signal X. It's partially observed by the observation through some noises. All the noises here are Brownian motions in multidimensional space. And I will call Y the observation generated by the observation. So the optimal filter, if you start Gaussian, is also a Gaussian random variable with a given mean and a given covariance. So that's already well known from everyone. So we go quite quickly from that. So the conditional mean and the covariance of the conditional distribution of X given the observations satisfy what is called the Kalman-Bussy filter. So it's quite simple. You do the prediction and then you do the correction with the innovation. See, this is the new part of observation you have at time t. And this is the gain in blue, and PT is the covariance, and the covariance satisfies offline autonomous equation, which is called the Riccati equation in matrix space. So Ric is the drift, so is AP plus PA prime, so that's the linear part. You have R, and you have an extra term here, which is a quadratic term, and S, it's always C prime sigma, which is this one, and C. Okay, so I will use this notation all the time in the article. So Ric is the Riccati drift. So if you take S, C equal to zero, so that means that you don't observe anything. So it's like the covariance of the process X. And this is nothing but, let's say, the evolution of the covariances of, let's say, an Ornstein-Lembeck process, for example. So if S is zero, it's the prior covariances. But if S is not zero and you observe something, these are the conditional covariances. So the Riccati drift, I will call it Riccati, Ric. Okay, so the idea of particle methods is to find a diffusion which will be driven by extra noises, such that when you look at the law of the diffusion, when you fix the observations, then this law coincides with the optimal filter, that is with the Gaussian, with this mean, conditional mean, and this covariance we have just discussed. And I allow this diffusion to be nonlinear in the sense that they satisfy the diffusion equation, but this diffusion equation depends itself on the law of the process through their covariance matrices. So if I look at the diffusion, for example, the diffusion coefficient may depend on the covariance of the law of the state at that time. So E is the identity, So that's a column vector. So this is a column vector. This is a row vector. So here is the covariance of the law of the process at that time. So here are plenty of examples. In fact, there is an infinitely many solutions. The first one is called the vanilla. It's the continuous time analog of the original filter introduced by Evensen in 94 or 92. So it's defined like that. So you see there is an extra noise which has nothing to do with the other noises. So that's a new diffusion. But you see here, it depends on the covariance of the law of the process itself. So that means that to sample this diffusion, you cannot do it except if you can compute the law of the process, and in particular, the covariance of the law of that state. So that's a nonlinear diffusion. There are two extra noises, one here and one here. So these two extra noises have the same, are independent copies of these two guys. So you put the information, the observations here, you sample extra noises. So this will be a way to sample this diffusion, but you need to compute the covariance of the law of this process. The second example is without this noise. So without this noise, you can take this solution. So you take the state, you add the expectation. Remember that x, e of x is x. So when you do eta t of e is the column vector with all the expectation of each coordinates. So you take the state, you add the mean of the process, you divide by two, and that's the way to simplify this. So you can take this zero, but you need to replace this by this. You keep the noise here, and this is the analog of the continuous time analog of the what they call the deterministic ensemble Kalman filter introduced by Sakov and Ok in 2008. What is funny is that if you take the discrete time version, which is the one introduced by Sakov and Ok, in discrete time, it's not consistent. So it means that it doesn't satisfy the property we are looking for. If you look at the law of the discrete time variables, they don't coincide with the optimal filter. But in continuous time, it's correct. If you do the continuous time analog, then the law of this process, when you fix the observation, coincide with the optimal filter. And so you see there are less randomness here because we sample, of course, the noise of the signal, but we no more sample the observation noise here. There are less noise. The third example is the continuous time analog of an algorithm introduced by Reich and Kotter in 2013. I will not discuss on this because this one is purely deterministic. There are no noise here and no noise here. So as you can see, except the initial starting point, everything is deterministic, of course, except the observation, but there is no extra noises. So the prediction is this, and you add these quantities, and you can check that the law of this random variable, given the observation, coincides with the optimal filter. So of course, to check that, you need to do some calculations. So I will just ask you today to trust me. These three examples, and in fact, you can add to this example any term of that form for some skew symmetric matrix. You just do plus this term with any skew symmetric matrix, which may depend on the law of the process. And then all of these processes, when you look at the law of the random variable given the observations, they satisfy this property. They coincide with the optimal filter. And of course, all of them, if I ask you to sample this one, or this one, you will not be able to sample these processes because you need to compute the covariance of the law of the state variable. So the trick is always the same. You do a particle approximation. So I will just do the first case, otherwise I can continue for hours on that. But in fact, you just copy this, but instead of sampling one of them, you sample plenty of them, and when you need it, you replace the sample, you replace the unknown covariance of the law by the sample covariance. This is exactly what is written here. You sample the same equation as before, but instead of the covariance of the law of the process, you take the sample covariance, which means the covariance associated with the empirical measure. And there is always, when you work with the sample covariances, to avoid a bias, there is always a rescaling like that, at least for IID random variables. Here, they are not IID because each particle depends on the sample averages, which are written here. So each particle, as you can see, depends on the sample average through their sample covariances. But this factor is important. At least in the beginning, when you do that at time zero, when you start with IID copies of the signal, these are IID, these are the sample mean of IID. And you know that if you do this operation, the sample covariance will be independent of the sample mean of IID variables. And you can, if you add this factor, it's unbiased. So for at any time, even if there are interactions, it's important to preserve this rescaling property. Okay, so this is the example. As you can see, I can do exactly the same here. Sample plenty of them, replace this by the sample covariance. Here I can do plenty of them, meaning that they start from different IID condition of the signals. And each time you need, you replace the sample covariance, which are purely deterministic, except from the start. Okay, so the question is, when you write this, you don't see any form of the Kalman filter, and here you have the sample covariances, which are computed, let's say, sequentially. And the question is, where are the Kalman-Bussy filter? So I need to take the sample mean of that. And where are the Riccati equations? Because we need to compare the sample covariances with the true Riccati equation. Because we know intuitively that these sample covariances converge to the solution of the Riccati equation. So let's start with the first theorem that says that if you look at the vector of the sample means of each coordinate, they satisfy exactly the same equation as the ensemble Kalman filter, except that here you have the sample covariances, which I denote with a little p. And in fact, for each coordinate, so the sample mean of each coordinate satisfy this equation plus a perturbation term of the order of the Monte Carlo order. And here each coordinate is perturbed by a martingale. So that means that this is a vector, and this is a vector where each entry is a martingale. So you have a R dimensional martingale, R being the dimension of the signal. And of course, because you have a martingale of dimension R, if you take two of them, two coordinates, you have the product. If you make the product, you have the product of two martingales. They are not a martingale. The product is not a martingale. But if you subtract the let's say, if you take the entry I and the entry J, you multiply the martingale I and the martingale J, you subtract the IJ entry of this matrix, and you obtain a martingale. So of course, this is not the usual angle bracket of real value martingale. This is the angle bracket of vector value martingales. That's nothing. In fact, it's just to say that if I take the entry IJ, I compute the entry IJ of this, and this is precisely what I need to subtract to the product of the I and the J to make a martingale. But what is important here, if you prefer, you can keep the dimension one to avoid these sophisticated notations. But in the case one, you remember we add noise, we added the noise in the signal and the observation, and the U and the V are not null. U correspond to the covariance of the signal noise, and V correspond to the S we discussed in the beginning. So the S we just wrote here. So that's the S. The R is the noise of the signal. So here it is. So in case one, let's say these two factors are not zero. But in case two, because we didn't sample the noise of the observation, the second factor here is zero. So that means that the covariance here doesn't depend on P. In the third case, because it's a pure transport, there are no extra martingale. The randomness, as I said, comes from the starting point. So during the evolution, there are no extra noise coming in. It's only from the starting point. So that's normal. The randomness and the error and the fluctuation come from the beginning, not during the evolution. So in the third case, you are exactly equal to the Kalman filter, except that instead of starting from the sample the true expectation, you start from the sample mean. So the third case is extremely simple, because if you look at the Kalman filter, the stability of the Kalman filter, how it forgets the initial condition, gives you precisely what you are looking for, because instead of starting from the true expectation of the initial variable of the signal, you start from the sample mean. So that's it. So in this case, it's extremely simple. This one is simpler because you don't have this extra term. And this one is the more sophisticated because you have here a covariance of a diffusion, which is quadratic here. So now, if you look at the sample covariance matrices here, remember, the little p is the sample covariance up to some factor. The capital P, the capital, oops, sorry. Like this. Yeah, the capital P satisfies the Riccati equation. So the little p is the sample covariance matrix. It satisfies the Riccati equation. So that for this part, we are happy with that. And there is a perturbation. And the problem now, let's say mathematical and notational problem, is that this is a matrix. So each entry of the matrix satisfies, let's say, the Riccati corresponding coordinate equation plus a martingale. So for each KL entry of the sample covariance, there is a perturbation which is given by a martingale. So of course, here, instead of having a vector, you have a matrix value martingale. So if I take the entry KL and I take the entry IJ, I multiply these two entries and it's not a martingale, but if I subtract correctly some tensors, then I obtain a martingale. So that's more or less in a complex way of writing, but just to say that if I multiply two martingale entries, I have a way using tensor notation to describe what I need to subtract to have again a martingale. So that's called the angle bracket of tensors value martingales. So you can see here you have again the PT, so that's common to everyone, but you have again the parameters U and V, which are different in the three cases. Third case, 0, 0, so no more martingale. In the case two, this is 0, so you have a nice form. But in the first case, these two are not zeros. So if these two are not zero, you can see you have P and P squared, so you have a cubic diffusion. So you may have explosive alert discrete scheme when you try to discretize this type of equations. But something which is interesting to look at is that usually for IID samples, the sample mean and the sample covariance are independent. Here, the analog is the martingale arising here and the martingale arising here, so the M bar and the M, these two martingales are orthogonal. So that's a very important property because it says that the sample mean and the sample covariance satisfy the same equation as the ensemble, as the Kalman-Bussy filter and the Riccati equation up to some fluctuations, which are orthogonal.
So just a silly question, yeah. I mean, the M, then this martingale constructed out of this product is automatically guaranteed to provide almost surely the positive definiteness on the little p.
In fact, if you take the sample covariance, sorry,
that is automatic.
Yeah, you just write the sample covariance is equal to that. Mm-hmm. You do the calculation, and you end up on this equation.
Okay, good.
There is no choice. Okay. In fact, it's the sample covariance equal to that.
Perfect.
And so now you can ask the question, well, if I don't put one square root of n and I put an epsilon. And in fact, if you put an epsilon, it's a time rescaling. So in fact, it means that you are looking at the sample covariance on a different time scale.
Nice.
Okay, so it will be always the same. So that's, let's say if I take S equal to 0, this will become, as we discussed in the beginning here, as I said, if I don't observe anything, so if C equal to 0, this S is 0, and in that case, you have no observation because C equal to 0, okay? See, so this part disappears. And so if this part, if, sorry, if this part disappears, this is the sample covariance of IID copies of an Ornstein-Uhlenbeck. So what you are looking here, in fact, is what is called in practice the Wishart process. So if you take C equal to zero, this will be the Wishart process.
Mm-hmm.
When C is not zero, it's an extended version. We can say it's a Riccati process, I don't know. We call it a stochastic Riccati equation. But it comes from the sample covariance matrices.
Perfect. Thank you.
Okay, so now another way of looking, because when I wrote this, you can see these martingales are difficult to see what it is. I wrote the angle bracket. So if you write the angle bracket, these martingales are continuous. I'm just working with diffusions. All the diffusions are continuous processes, even the sample covariances. So these are continuous martingale. I know the angle bracket. So by the representation theorem, I can write everything in terms of Brownian motions. So the nice way to do that is to say, okay, let's call epsilon 2 by square root of n. When I do parenthesis sim, it means that this is a matrix and this is the symmetric part. So the symmetric part of a matrix is when you take the matrix, you add the symmetric and you divide by 2. And it's just because I divide by 2 that I have a new factor 2 here, okay? So in fact, this is exactly what you need to plug to have precisely this angle bracket. So it's very simple to see. Now with this expression, W is a matrix, R by R matrix. Each entry is a Brownian motion. So you take a matrix of independent Brownian motion in each entry. You multiply by the square root of P, the square root of this quantity, and you symmetrize. And this is exactly the evolution equation up to a change of gravity space, let's say up to some orthogonal transformation on the noise here. This is exactly the evolution equation of the sample covariances of the ensemble Kalman filter in the three cases we have just discussed. Of course, playing if U and V are zero or not zero and so on. So as I said, if I take U and V equal to zero, this martingale disappears. And this is the pure Riccati equation. But as I said, I start from the sample covariance. The case two, sorry, is the deterministic. The case two is when V is equal to, this is when I observe nothing, when S is zero. And as I said, when V is zero, so when this term is zero, you can look at this equation without that and without that. And that's called the Wishart process. So the effect of the square is interesting because even if the drift A drives P very far away, the more it goes far, the more this guy take it back. Okay, so that's very important because the Wishart process, he has not this term. So if A is very large, this guy goes to infinity very quickly and there is no way to take it back. But here, because of S, even if A is unstable, this guy will take it back. So that's why the Kanban-Busi is able to track unstable transient signals. Okay, so now we can look at this and we say we have a nice probabilistic equation. Let's look at diagonal matrices. So I take A, R, S, the A, the R, and the S, diagonal. So that's the identity matrix. And I take alpha, beta, and gamma. And I take V equal to zero and U equal to identity. So it should be simpler. Well, if you look at that, you obtain the Dyson equation. The Dyson equation, in fact, in a more complicated way, because PT now is nothing, it has non-colliding eigenvalues. PT is symmetric, so it has a real value, real eigenvalues. If you look at the evolution of the eigenvalues, you start ranking them from the start. And they will not, the ranking will not change in time because of the repulsion given by the Dyson equation. So believe me, this type of equation, if you look on the literature on Dyson equation, is more complex than the conventional Dyson equation. And it's very complicated to analyze if you write this type of things. This is a repulsion that makes, if the two are very close, the repulsion is extremely strong. So that's why you will not have crossing of the eigenvalue. So for when if you take gamma equal to zero, I don't remember, there are some parts, this can be connected to non-intersecting Brownian motions or things like that. So it's very complicated to analyze this. So that was for diagonal matrices. So you can imagine that studying this type of object, which is not for diagonal matrices, is a bit tricky. But so at the end of the day, you say, okay, let's look at dimension one, because in dimension one, this has a nice expression. So in dimension one, let's look at the deterministic Riccati equation. So there are no perturbation. And this Riccati equation has two fixed points, which I can compute. One fixed point is given by this formula. So omega minus is the negative fixed point, is A minus lambda by two. So it's A minus this divided by S. And the positive fixed point is A plus the square root divided by S. So you have two positive fixed points. One is negative and one is positive. And in dimension one, the Riccati equation, if you start below this fixed point, you increase exponentially fast to the fixed point. And if you start above the fixed point, you decrease exponentially fast to this fixed point. So this is what is written here. So if you start somewhere, you converge to the fixed point exponentially fast, and the exponential rate is precisely given by this. And this is a quantity we will need later on. It's a very important quantity to keep in mind, is the A minus PS. So keep in mind that if I see an exponential, an integral A minus PS, I have an exponential decay. Okay, something important to see or to connect to what I said before is that we have the Riccati equation. Let's say it's associated to a signal which is unstable. So A may be 1000. So even in that case, the Riccati equation will converge to the fixed point exponentially fast. And you can see that the rate of convergence here doesn't depend on the sign of A. If you have 1000, it's even better. You will converge even faster. So that's important. And it's also true for the multivariate case. You don't care about the stability or not of the signal. You always converge to the fixed point exponentially fast. And in dimension one, you can do the calculation to see precisely what is the rate of convergence and to study this A minus PS.
So can I ask a question?
Yep.
Okay, so this interpretation that you said is very nice, right? This A is explosive part of the non-observed process, and then the PS is what comes from the observation. So if we go to the multivariate case, should we say that every unstable the manifold should be met by a corresponding measurement that pulls it back, and that will be enough to control the stability of the system?
Yes, it's exactly this. If you have observability and controllability, then you are able to control the unstable directions using the observations.
Thank you.
So maybe I will, yeah. That's another important point. Again, in dimension one, so it's not the covariance, it's simply the variance. So now the variance satisfies a one-dimensional diffusion. So that's a one-dimensional diffusion in dimension one. And you see that's a simple Brownian motion. You have the square root of the sample of the covariance of the martingale, which can be written like that. I will not discuss on that. But what is important is that in the case one, so that means that if U and V are not zero, then this diffusion in dimension one has an invariant measure, in fact, a reversible measure, which has evitate. So we can write the reversible measure of that form. So that's a tangent inverse. So this is a constant. This cannot explode. It's just written because it is like that, but that's a bounded function. And what is important to see is this evitate polynomial tape here, which depend on the ratio R by U, but more importantly on epsilon squared. So epsilon is related, so epsilon squared, let's say, is 1 by capital N, N being the number of samples. So if you want, the tails are lighter and lighter. To have lighter tails, you need to increase the number of particles. So that's important, because if you look at some moments of the ensemble Kalman filter in case one, so the vanilla ensemble Kalman filter. Let's say you look at the 10th moment. If the 10th moment is infinite, if you start with the invariant measure, there will be no way for you to control these moments uniformly in time. No way. They will explode one of these days. And I'm just talking about the Riccati equation, so that the Riccati equation is the one entering in the game. So now the second case, which is called the deterministic Sakovenok ensemble Kalman filter, which I remind you in discrete time is not consistent. So not consistent means that if you take the number of particles to infinity, if you have infinite computational power, your algorithm will not converge to the optimal filter. But in continuous time, it is true. If you take the number of particles to infinity, the continuous time Sakovenok filter converges to the optimal filter. But in that case, what is important is that we don't sample the noise of the observation. And in that case, we only have U, which is strictly positive. And in this situation only, you have Gaussian type tails. You have a reversible measure, which can be written like that. And that's very important. Because in this case, of course, all the moments of the Riccati equation can be controlled uniformly in time, which was not the case in this one. In this one, you need enough particle to control some moments. And if you want to control higher moments, you need to increase the number of particles. There is no way. In the beginning, I thought I was doing some mistakes because each time I was trying to control the moments in the first case, it was for sufficiently large number of particles. And at the end of the day, it was obvious that we cannot do better because we have evitated reversible measures. So I don't have, yes, I have half an hour. So of course we can do, we did a lot of work on that because it was one dimensional case. So if you write the Riccati equation in one dimension is a diffusion, a one dimensional diffusion. You can look at some distance between the law of the process starting from some measure or starting from another measure. We already discussed the invariant measure. So we can look at how fast we go to the invariant measure. And in fact, we can, if the number of particles is large enough, the rate of convergence is more or less the rate of convergence of the Riccati equation. Sorry, it's here. So that was the rate, lambda, is the rate of convergence of the deterministic Riccati equation to the fixed point. And in fact, for the diffusion, which is almost the same plus a small perturbation, it's not so simple, but to prove that the convergence of the diffusion to the invariant measure, the rate is almost the rate of the true Riccati equation. So you can reach the rate of the Riccati equation, the deterministic one, if you have enough particles. Of course, to characterize this parameter, it's a bit tricky and there is a lot of notations. But it's just, let's say, a theoretical result, which is reassuring in the sense that the diffusion or the Riccati equation in dimension one, let's say, is more or less the same when the number of particles is large. So that's another property that says that if you have enough particles, then any exponential of that form decays exponentially fast. So as I said, A may be unstable, but we expect this, as Raoul said, we expect this guy to stabilize. We expect A minus PS to be stable, even if this guy is unstable. And this property is correct if you have enough particles. So that means that there exists some epsilon. So if you are more below, so less fluctuation means more particles. If you have enough particles, yes, you have exponential decays of exponentials like that. So we can do plenty of results mathematically like that. So let's come back to the multivariate case. So in the multivariate case, when you compare the conditional expectation to the true signal, you believe me, if you just replace the observation by the signal plus noise, you obtain this type of formula. So that's an equality. You can check it as an exercise. You look at the evolution of this guy. You look at the evolution of X. And you write everything in terms of the noises of X. So the noise of X, you see X is here and the noise. And the observation is Cx plus noise. So that's why this noise comes from the observation. So when you look at the difference between this and this, you follow this equation. So this is purely noise. And if you want to stabilize the extra noise coming here, you need this guy to be stable. Because you have a linear process with some noise. Don't care about this form, but that's some noise. If you want to stabilize, you need this one to be stable. So in fact, there is the theory of ensemble Kalman, the theory of Kalman and Bussy. There were plenty of errors from the beginning, but they were corrected up to 2001, I think. If you have enough observability and enough controllability, there exists a single fixed point matrix such that A minus PS, when you plug the fixed point here, the spectral abscissa of this guy is negative. So that means that if you have observability and controllability, there exists a positive fixed point of the Riccati equation such that if you replace this guy by the fixed point, you will obtain the steady state filter, the steady state Kalman filter, and the steady state Kalman filter is stable because it will stabilize these guys. Okay, so that's a very important property. So as I said, it's even if the A is unstable. So even if the signal is unstable, thanks to observability and controllability, the filter will follow the signal. So if the signal is unstable, the X hat is unstable. This is the only way. But the difference between the two is stabilized because of this factor. Okay, so now let's look at the linear system and exponential semigroup. In the deterministic case, you look at the evolution equation of the Riccati equation, and I call this the solution. So if I start from P naught, phi t P naught means is the solution of the system at time t. So when you look at the exponential written like that, we are not in one dimension. So if you look at, let's say, an equation, so S is little than t. If you look at this evolution equation forward or this evolution equation backward, they are linear because this is a matrix, this is a matrix, and this is another matrix. So this is a matrix evolution equation, but it's very tempting to write that this is an exponential, but it's not the true exponential because you write this as the starting point. The starting point is the identity plus the integral of this, but this is the identity plus the integral of the other one. And so you have a sum of iterated integrals, and the sum of iterated integral with time varying matrices is not the exponential. There is no way, except if the matrices commute, which is not the case in this situation. But you can write, let's say, as an exponential because they satisfy more or less the same rules. This is the Baker, Hausdorff-Baker decomposition. That's the identity plus the sum of iterated integrals. So that's not so simple to prove that these exponential semigroups are stable. Okay, of course, if you start from the fixed point, so if you start from the fixed point, this will be always the fixed point because by definition, the fixed point doesn't change in time. So if this is a deterministic matrix, then if this doesn't change in time, I call it A minus PS, and this integral is T minus S. So in that special case, the formula you have time-varying matrices here, but if you take the fixed point here, these guys will not be time-varying, and of course, by definition, they commute between them. So in that case, this will be a true exponential. And we know that this matrix is stable. So to quantify the norm of this exponential of a matrix is very simple if you have a stable matrix. In this situation, you cannot do it because it's not even a matrix. It's not even the integral of time-varying matrices. And in fact, it's even more complicated because of this observation. If you have these Magnusserie expansions with integral with the circle, and the matrices here, in our case, they are given by A minus PS. But if, as I said, these matrices do not commute, which is, there is no reason, at least in our case, for these matrices to commute, This is not an integral, is the traditional Magnus Seri expansion. If you want to write it in terms of an exponential, you will have the Lie algebra coming in, which doesn't really help. And the main problem is that there exist some cases where these matrices have the spectrum which is always negative. So all the eigenvalues are negative. So you expect the system to be stable, but in fact it's unstable. And there are some examples where the spectrum, all the eigenvalues are positive. So you say, okay, the system is stable, but no, is unstable, but it's not true. In fact, the system can be stable. So there are some particular examples where it's very misleading in multidimensional case. The spectrum of this can be negative and the exponential one semigroup is unstable. And if these guys have a spectrum which is positive, this guy is stable. So that's a bit tricky to understand, but that's some property of the multivariate situation. So it's very simple to make plenty of errors if you work on that. Okay, so the continuous time algebraic Riccati, if you have observability and controllability, in fact, you have two fixed points, one negative, one positive of the Riccati equation in the multidimensional case. And in fact, I have 15 minutes. What is important is that we know the difference between the two. So if I take this minus this, I know that this is the limiting of a Gramian. So I can write the Gramian, this type of Gramian, and to show that the difference between these two points, remember this is negative, so minus negative is positive. So this one is positive, and you can see it's positive here. So if this guy is stable, this integral to infinity exists. So this delta t will converge to some quantity. I'm not saying it's simple to compute, but it's a mathematical result. This doesn't depend on the starting point. It's only, it depends on the positive fixed point. And so the difference between the two fixed points, the positive and the negative, is computable independently of the, yeah, it can be computable in terms of Gramians. And there is one theorem which is very convenient to work with, is to say, let's suppose you want to estimate the exponential of a time-varying exponential like that. Remember, it's not a true exponential, it's one parameter semigroup, or if you have a linear dynamical system with this type of time-varying matrices as a drift. So that's complicated because this is the starting point and that's the solution of the Riccati equation at time s. But in fact, there is a formula that tells you that you can put p, the fixed point. If you plug the fixed point here, this will be the fixed point and you will have a minus p infinity s, an homogeneous matrix time t. So this result tells you that this complicated object can be written in terms of the same object, but starting with the fixed point and some non-linear part. So you can say, okay, this is always true because I just can say that this is this divided by this. But if you do this divided by this, you expect this to grow exponentially in P. And in fact, this can be computed. And this CP, you can see, it's linear in P. So that means that this complicated object can be written with the fixed point, and this can be analyzed in a very simple form. And you simply need to control the inverse of a linear function. And that's very convenient because, as you can imagine, to estimate the norm of this is complicated. To estimate the norm of this is simple, and to estimate the norm of this is not so complicated because it's linear. Okay, so that's the theory, in fact, we developed with Adrien some years ago. And so if you look at uniform control of these guys uniformly in time, then it depends, there is a misprint. So if I put P, this is P. So it may grow linearly with P, because it's an inverse and so on. But if you let a little time here and you look at the supremum after time delta, then you can obtain something that doesn't depend on the starting point. So this is surprising, but believe me, it's true. It's if you wait a little time, this constant, of course, explodes when delta tends to zero, but it doesn't depend on the starting point. So that's convenient, because if you want to control these guys after some little time, let's say this is bounded, and this goes to zero exponentially fast. So that's very convenient to deal with this type of terms. Okay, so I will not discuss on this, otherwise I will not enter into more. So there are plenty of corollaries you can do. I will not discuss on this. Lipschitz examples. Let's go on that. Yeah, so let's go back to the answer. So yeah, just to tell you that thanks to this formula, sorry, thanks to this formula, you can obtain plenty of results, such, for example, if you compare the drift of the Riccati with Q1, Q2, you have a very simple formula that tells you that the difference between the two, there is a linear part here, that's the difference. So that tells you that the solution starting from Q1 or the solution starting from Q2 is the exponential semigroup associated to this, boom. The semigroup, exponential semigroup associated to this, you just copy what we have proved, apply to the difference. And you see here, you obtain the Lipschitz property for free. This is bounded, this is bounded, this exponential decay, and this is the Lipschitz part. And you obtain in a very simple way, you see there is one line, you obtain exponential decay of the solution Riccati starting from this or from this, just saying that you have the exponential semigroup associated to this, which can be written like that. The exponential semigroup associated to that, which can be written like that. And you obtain in a very simple way, plenty of results at every level. You can, so you obtain this one. If you look for any time larger than t is uniform, plenty of results. Okay, so let's come back to the original problem. For the ensemble Kalman filter, as I said, if you observe nothing, you have IID copies of the signal, so you end up with a Wishart process. The other problem is also related to what Raoul was saying, is that the rank of the sample covariance is always less than the number of samples, because for each sample, you have a rank one matrix. So if the number of sample is less than the dimension, which is typically what people are doing in practice, the dimension is huge, and they take a very small number of samples. So the rank will be not, it's not enough. So that shows that the number of dimension minus the rank you have succeed to obtain adding rank one matrices, there are all of these dimensions which are not driven by the observation. Because remember, P is related to the gain, and the gain is in front of the observation. So if the rank is not the rank of the dimension of the signal, that there are plenty of dimension of the signal which are not corrected using the observation. And this may be very bad. For example, in case one, in dimension one, you have evitates, and the exponential moments are infinite, and the moments are infinite if you don't have enough particles, and you may have moment explosions. And pure transport is very simple. We'll not discuss too much on that. So now let's come back to the same equation we had before, but instead of having the true conditional expectation, I have the ensemble Kalman now. So instead of x hat, I have the sample mean. So it's the same equation as before. So you have the extra noise, you have the martingale coming from the fluctuation, and instead of A minus the Riccati PS, now you have A minus sample mean S. So it's becoming more and more complicated, because instead of having the exponential semigroup A minus PS with P given by the Riccati, this guy is, let's say, the Riccati plus noise. So you have an exponential semigroup instead of the Riccati, you have the stochastic Riccati. So that's even more complicated. So you cannot apply the, 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 we cannot apply the theory, the Floquet theory we have developed. It doesn't apply to this situation. So you have, in fact, this, you see it's a linear process, but the matrix here is time varying and stochastic. So it's like if you have an Ornstein-Ellenbeck process with a time varying stochastic matrix. This is, let's say, extra noises. So the only way to say that the sample mean can track the signal is to ensure that this guy stabilizes the perturbations, the noisy perturbation, and the perturbation coming from the Monte Carlo sample. And in fact, it may be very ill-conditioned, because if you look at the symmetric part of this guy, you can have the symmetric part is positive, even if A is stable. So that means that, okay, I have A unstable, I expect this to stabilize. But even if A is stable, if this guy is stable, this guy may destroy the stability. Okay, so if A is stable, just subtracting this can destroy the stability. But, and the other problem is that you are always under bias. So that means that the sample mean, usually at time zero, it's equal. So I should have written less or equal. But after some runs, the expectations, so the bias, is always under bias. So it is why if the Riccati equation was able to stabilize, it's not clear why this sample one will stabilize. Okay.
So can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Yeah, coming back to this crucial term, A minus PTS.
This one.
So PT, in this case, again, was the sample covariance, right? So it may begin by A minus PTS having some stabilizing properties and then switch and then go back, right? I mean, it's not clear.
Clear at all.
So that makes like an Ornstein-Ellenbeck that sometimes is stable, sometimes it's unstable for the convergence of MT.
Yes, it's a very complicated object. Yes, it's very complicated because, as I said, if it's time varying, you may think that the eigenvalues are positive and in fact is stable, or you may think that the eigenvalues are negative and in fact they're unstable. And it's even worse, you can have A stable, but just doing this multiplication, you make it unstable. So it can be very complicated to analyze this type of object. It's possible in dimension one, as I said, it's possible. For example, in this, when I wrote that in dimension one, this is A minus P, that's the sample covariance. A minus sample covariance, so dimension one, so it's sample variance. So in that case, it's simple because it's dimension one. In dimension one, I'm subtracting a sample variance times something positive. And in that case, every expectation of the exponential decay exponentially fast, as the Riccati equation. But that's the dimension one is a very particular case. And the way to prove this is not so simple. It looks apparently simple, but at least the way we prove it was to make a change of probability to change the drift of the diffusion. And so changing the drift of the diffusion make a change of potential, so that may be useful to control this. So you cannot say that this is negative, but if I add a term coming from the change of probability, I can obtain this type of bounds. I can obtain a lower bound just adding the change of drift, the exponential change of probability, which is a typical H minus one generator applied to H. So playing a little with the H, I can obtain a lower bound using an exponential change of probability. Because as it is written here, there is no way to say that this is negative. So we can go from here to here, assuring that the P is such that A minus PS is always less than minus one, say. No. So the only way to do is, at least the way we did, is to say, let's do a change of probability. So I change the process. But if I change the process, doing a change of probability, I will have an extra term, which is H minus one LH. And the H minus one LH is in fact with a minus. So I'm looking for H such that this minus H minus one LH is less than something negative. And then I can do it. So it's very, I would say that's the most complicated part of the analysis, is to understand, not in dimension one, because in dimension one is done, and let's say it's a open door at least to have some result. But in the multidimensional case, I would say the question is open. If you have sample covariance matrices here. In the multidimensional case, I don't know. We can say things, but not the one I would like. Okay, so now we have discussed on this. Yeah, so let's plot some result we have obtained. So again, the crucial part is to understand how this guy stabilizes. As soon as you understand how this guy stabilizes, of course, you can argue that the sample mean will not converge to the signal, but I'm just writing the key point to understand, because the other points are very simple to analyze. Because if you compare M to the conditional expectation, you will not have this extra term, blah, blah. So it's simpler to analyze. That's the most difficult part. So the result we obtain is, let's say, if you assume that S is strictly positive, so you can change the basis function in such a way that the drift matrix and the S become the identity. And of course, if S become the identity, in some way it makes things easier. So the condition was to ensure that the log norm, so this means the log norm, sorry, the log norm of this A is strictly negative. So it's more or less to say that the signal is stable. So if the signal is stable, and if you have enough particle, then the covariance matrices and the true Riccati equation, or the sample mean and the true conditional mean for any mean error order, there is something wrong here. It should be one divided by little n, one divided by little n, otherwise multiply this, you take the power n, okay? So there is a misprint. It's the nth mean error. So this should be the norm, the nth norm. So one by n, to have square root of n here. So this result basically tells you that if the system is stable, we obtain sample covariance distance, the uniform in time mean error estimates between the sample covariance and the true covariance, and the sample mean and the true conditional mean. For the spectral of Frobenius norm, but in fact for any norm, because all the norms in the finite spaces are equivalent. But the spectral of Frobenius norm are the more easier to handle, especially if you have dynamical system just playing with the multiplication with the transpose. So I was very happy to have this type of result, even for stable systems. And then I met Adrian Bishop, and he told me that this type of result is obvious. Because if the signal is stable, the observation, let's say, is stable, the particle, because they do the predictions, are stable. So if everyone goes to zero exponentially fast, it's natural to have something uniform in time. And then we start collaborating, because he told me the critical point is to prove that if it's unstable, you can stabilize the system. So this is what we start doing with Adrian Bishop, and this is why we start a lot of collaboration. So we obtain, let's say, the same type of result with only observability and controllability. So it allows unstable signals if you have enough observability and enough controllability. So we have uniform Riccati estimate of the same form. So that's funny, because we can be as close as we want to the solution of the Riccati equation with a uniform in time precision order up to correcting the misprint, of course. Even if we have the under bias estimate, that means that the guy is random. In the average is less than the true Riccati. We know that this can stabilize, but this guy, even if it's always under bias, is able to stabilize the Riccati equation. But it's not because you can stabilize the Riccati equation. So for example, when you replace P by capital P, you pay an error. So it means that you have, let's say, something which is stable plus a perturbation, which is random. So you can say, okay, if I have the true, which is stable, plus a perturbation, I should be able to say something. But it's not so simple because this perturbation change in time, and there is no way to control uniformly in time what they are doing for the same trajectory of randomness. So it's very complicated to use this trick to say that it's just because I have this type of estimate on the covariances that I will obtain the result on the sample covariance. So what I'm saying is that the road from here to here is complicated. The road from here to here is very complicated. So
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Can I ask this theorem one, do you have an extension to a time discretization as well? So some time integration.
Yeah, we start. We have done one that will go. We will put this to archive soon, I think. But it's only in dimension one. We have not succeeded to do this not yet in multidimensional case.
Okay.
So in continuous time, it's clear. In discrete time, dimension one, it's clear. Let's say. Again, yes, it's clear. The dimension one is very particular. The dimension one is you can prove it. The dimension one is more or less what we did. Yes, what we did for this in dimension one. So for one dimensional Riccati diffusion. So everything we did in dimension one in this article, we have done it for the discrete time case.
And you do it with Euler-Maruyama numerical integration, or?
Sorry?
Do you do it with Euler-Maruyama numerical integration, or?
I'm not doing discrete time. I'm not doing time discretization. I'm doing discrete time, pure discrete time.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Okay. I'm looking at the ensemble Kalman filter in discrete time. And I can even tell you that my constant, if I take the time step tends to zero, If it comes from a continuous time model, they will probably explode with the time step.
I see. Okay, because I wondered whether you could approximate the continuous time filter using a discretization of time, so a numerical integration in time as well.
That's complicated. You want to find estimates that go through discrete to continuous and bounds that will not explode when the time step tends to zero. And it is complicated and open question, at least for me, it's an open question. I'm not looking at this. When I've started looking at the discrete time, and I was looking on the way to go from continuous to discrete, in the beginning, I was trying to have the estimates not exploding when the time step tends to zero, if I was one day applying this for time discretization. And in fact, I stopped because it's a bit tricky to write. And at the end of the day, some estimates were okay if the time step tends to zero, some other estimates were not okay. So I start saying, okay, let's say it's a constant, but the only thing I can say is that the constants I have obtained explode when the time step tends to zero. Maybe some of them not, but in general, most of them, let's say not 80%.
But I guess it also could depend on the, I mean, you presented three different McKean-Vlasov type filters. I guess it could depend on the method.
Yeah, but as I said, in the three cases we have discussed, the vanilla, when the time step tends to zero, there is a link between the two. But the second model, the Sakov-Enoch, if you take the time discretization, you lose the consistency. So if you write the Markov chain corresponding to the discrete time Sakov-Enoch, so the ensemble Kalman filter corresponding to the Sakov-Enoch, you take the number of particles to infinity, so you obtain a kind of Kalman type filter, and it's not the optimal filter.
Yes.
So in fact, when we looked at the discrete time, pure discrete time, without thinking about continuous time approximation and so on. So pure discrete time, the only consistent one we can look at was the vanilla, not the other ones. So exactly in this situation, so that was the very last result that we discussed today. So uniform Riccati can be proved. So as I said, this is very simple, but it's not because you are as close as P as you want at a given time and uniformly in time. This uniform in time, of course, is not inside. And so there is no way to control the fluctuation A minus little ps and to compare to A minus capital PS. Okay, so that's complicated because you have the mean of an exponential. And so if you have uniform in time, in fact, it's for every time you take an expectation. So this can be, let's say, every 10 times you can change the algorithm, it will be the same result. So this is easier than this. So this, for all the situations, for all the three cases, vanilla, Sakovenok, and purely deterministic in a trivial way, we obtain under only observability and controllability this type of estimate, even if it's under bias. And we obtain uniform type estimate of that form, uniform type rate in case two, only if the log norm of A minus PS is negative. And this is a very strong condition, because the only thing we know is that A minus PS is stable. So it's Hurwitz. If it's Hurwitz, means that the spectral abscissa is negative. So this can be positive. You can have a spectral abscissa negative, but the log norm is positive. So that means that this is a stronger requirement to have in the Sakovenov case, some type of things like that on some compact interval whose length increase with the number of particles. So I can even say that this type of estimate for unstable signals are unknown if we put the soup in time here, except in dimension one. Okay, in dimension one, we know all of this, but in dimension more than one, there are this type of complexity. So I would say it's an open, important research project to show that if this spectral abscissa of this guy is negative, for the Sakovenok, for example, we have uniform in time estimate of the state. So I repeat, the only thing we succeed is I have supremum on time. So the more I have particle, the more the time interval can be bigger. And the time interval tends to infinity when the number of particle increase. So that means I have more and more uniformity in time, but it's not the soup in time. Okay, so this type, and in fact, it's not the spectral abscissa. This is under a stronger condition. The log norm of this matrix is negative. So you take this, you add the symmetry, you add the transpose, and divide by two. Okay? And so even to find a condition in terms of the parameter of the system that satisfies this, not so simple. In the general case, because this is a fixed point, depends on the matrices A or S, and apart in some reversible case, you don't have an explicit description. Okay, we obtain also bias type Taylor expansion, robustness, blah, 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 because something which people are doing, which may be important to say, and then I will stop because I'm just increasing too much, is that if this A minus PS is unstable, if you add some epsilon identity, if you subtract epsilon identity, so that means that you take P and you add epsilon identity, you expect to make this more stable. So if doing this, it's what people call inflations. So if you add some inflation, of course, you introduce some new bias, and you are able to stabilize the indirect direction of the signal because you are using a finite number of samples, which is too low in comparison with the dimensions, and the unstable directions are unknown. So doing this trick, you can hopefully stabilize a little bit. Okay, so thank you. I will stop this. Thanks for